Welcome back to this episode of Tenebris Fabulas. In this episode we will talk about a serial killer again, one that is a bit close to home for me, because he also killed someone in the Netherlands, country where I'm from, but he also killed people in Germany and Slovakia. In total he killed 9 people in the span of 2 years, from the 1990s to the 1992. Also, coincidentally, the year which I was born in, so it's a bit close to my life. Of course, I'm talking about the international killer, or the sock killer, and his real name is André Rigo. So let's start with the question: who was André Rigo? André Rigo was born on December 17th, 1955, in Modra, Czechoslovakia. He was arrested in 1992. And is still alive to this day, so he's been in prison for 28 years. In his span of crime from 1990 to 1992, he killed 9 people and wounded one of them, killed them with different kind of weapons, and also committed necrophilia on his bodies. So, after his birth, he had a rough childhood. He is from Roma ethnicity, according to some sources. When he was 14, he was taken into a youth corrective institution, and later he was in an orphanage together with his siblings. They stayed there for over a year, be taken from their mother after their father's arrest, because his father was also not the nicest guy on this planet. Rico's mother died in 2000 after being hit by a car, and this was the only time he remembers that he cried in his life, and this is of course after the 9 people he killed and the 1 people he wounded. So you can see that he put a lot more emotional stock in his mother than he did in the people whose life he took. In an interview in 2007, he said that his parents were good to him. They didn't beat him. That was the only argument he gave why his parents were good for him. Weird to say, but I don't really know what kind of conditions he grew up in and what kind of beatings his friends have to endure in his surroundings. So maybe it was for him a great childhood, not being beaten, but it sounds like something that should be normal in a child's youth. Before his first arrest, and yes, I'm saying first arrest, because he got arrested multiple times in his life, but it was all before his first murder, and the last time he got arrested was also his last time he can be arrested, because he got a life imprisonment, thank God. He worked some odd jobs. He worked for a hotel named Carlton. That's the hotel where he got arrested for the first time. He worked in a heater room for the Pravda newspaper, and he also worked in a hospital. Two different hospitals even. But his life of crime started fairly young. He got convicted 11 times before his first murder, and he was the criminal from a young age. He started off with burglaries. And mostly home burglaries. And the last time he was in police custody in Slovakia, it was from September 28, 1998 to December 9, 1998, because of unauthorized leaving of the Republic. Back then there were some tensions in the Republic, and that's the reason he got caught. After the fall of the Iron Curtain and the end of communism in Czechoslovakia, people were allowed once again to travel freely in Europe, and Rigo continued with his crimes abroad. On December 9th, 1999, the same day he was released from prison, and mere 3 weeks after the start of the revolution, he went to Vienna without a valid passport. In Vienna, he acquired a fake Yugoslavian passport under the name Nedo Ikic. I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, otherwise, it's the fake name of a piece of shit, so I don't really... not really caring whether I say it correctly or not. Later he traveled to Germany to meet his brother. In Bavaria he asked for asylum using his fake passport, but how he was sentenced by the German authorities because of his fake passport. He went to prison for 2 months for forging documents, and he spent his sentence in a prison in Bad Reichenhall. After his release from prison, Rico escaped from a refugee camp and traveled to Munich, where he continued his burglaries and started his killing spree. So, before we start off with his victims, who he killed, where he killed him, why he killed him, etc., he had a specific modus operandi, which I'm going to go through, because it was an important factor in the conviction. Because he had this constant modus operandi, his constant way of killing these people. And because he had this pattern, they could connect all these cases with each other. And that's the main reason he got convicted in the end. So, first of all, his attack occurred during the night or very early in the morning. Not really weird, just time-based. Maybe it was it's convenient because he had a job to do during the day and went out and killed someone in the night. What was weird is that he wore socks on his hands all the time during his attacks. He did this in order not to leave any fingerprints. I would think you'd just buy some gloves. But no, he decided to put his socks over his hands and act like there were some weird sock pops or something. He would sneak into apartments in the basement on the ground floor, or with easy access via the balcony, usually entering through a window that was partially opened or easily accessible. And he would always pick women who were sleeping alone. And after he got into their homes, he would beat them to death with a metal rod, a wooden stick, or a rock. He would always hit them in the head, just to be sure that he killed them. He always left his murder weapon at the crime scene. And I think he also found most of his murder weapons at the crime scene as well. But not all of them, so it's not consistently in his modus operandi. After killing his victim, he would cover the victim's upper body with a blanket. Then he would copulate with the body, both in the front and also in the back. Sometimes he would also mutilate the body during intercourse. He also smoked at the crime scene and threw the cigarette butts on the floor. DNA testing wasn't as prevalent as it is now, so it was easier to leave DNA traces all over the crime scene and not be linked to the crime with your DNA. He would also rob his victims. Usually he would steal easy valuables like jewelry or watches or, you know, small things he could put in his pocket or his backpack and take with him while he left the crime scene. Alright, now let's jump into this weird-ass guy, his killing spree. After arriving in Munich, Andre Rico murdered twice in 3 months. His first victim, Helena S., she was 40 years old, probably surprised Rico while he was burglarizing her apartment. He killed her, probably because he didn't want her to call the cops or something, and got aroused sexually by his killings. This is all from Anton Heretic, the author of Rico's Psychological Evaluation During Investigation. It was the night of June 7th to June 8th in 1990, where he sneaked through a partially open window into the ground floor bedroom of Helena S. at an unspecified location in Munich. And he started burglarizing the apartment and got caught by Helena herself. At which point he grabbed a metal pipe weighing about 2.5 kilograms. And he would bash her head in. He would wrap the upper body part of her body in a blanket and had sex with her body. Before leaving her, according to some sources, he stole some easy to carry valuables. According to others, he stole nothing. Maybe because he was so flustered by what happened. Seeing this was his first experience with death and with necrophilia. I could imagine he was a bit of his usual game. He disposed the murder weapon directly beneath the bedroom window, so the metal pipe he just dropped where he entered the apartment. And not long after that, on the night of the last day of June and August 1st, 1990, Rico sneaked through the partially open balcony door into the Munich apartment of Ilke Z. She was 28 years old. He immediately murdered her, so instead of being accidentally caught, he just went in with the idea or with the intention to kill her. He used the metal pipe again, and probably during the copulation, he started to stab her into the neck with a screwdriver, and he performed both vaginal and anal intercourse with her. Afterwards, he covered up the body and searched the house for valuables, including a golden necklace and an unknown amount of German marks. He took these items with him, and the murder weapon and a man's sock were later found by the German police at the crime scene. So again, he left his murder weapon and the man's socks, which he probably wore over his hands to avoid leaving fingerprints. In October, Rico left Munich and he went to Amsterdam to visit his sister Helena. Maria van der Wey, she was 58, was a woman living alone in Amsterdam with a couple of cats. So typical cat lady living at home, enjoying life. And during the night of September 27, 1990, Rigo sneaked into her ground floor apartment through a partially open balcony window and killed her with a stone weighing over 5.5 kilograms. This was probably a pavement cobblestone. So again, he just took a weapon he found at the apartment and started killing the people, his victims, with. He stripped the body naked and copulated with it. Again, he robbed his victim, stealing a camera, a woman's wristwatch, two boxes containing coins and some other valuables. In the kitchen on a shelf, he finds some Silfofika. I have no idea what this is and I have no idea how to say it. Apparently it's a drink. And later in court, one of the witnesses will testify that Rico had a liking to this particular drink. Again, no idea. I will probably Google it later and maybe try it out if it's still available somewhere around here. After killing Maria van der Wey in Amsterdam, Rico left for Bratislava in Slovakia the day following the murder. His killings continued with the murder of Teresa R., who he was 88. She was living inside a retirement home in Bratislava. It's clear to see he doesn't have an age preference or a specific type he wants to kill. He just wants to kill and have sex with the bodies. On October 6, 1990, he murdered her with his fist while she was sleeping. The retirement home reported prayer books, rosary, and 4,000 Slovak crowns were missing. Underneath the balcony, the police found some Dutch coins and cigarette butts with Rigo's biological material on them. On January 3rd, 1991, early in the morning, the bodies of Anna P., who was 40, and her son, Jure N., 14 or 16, it depends on the sources, they were both found inside a ground floor flat, inside a dormitory, in an unspecified location in Bratislava. Rico entered the apartment through a window around midnight. The son was sleeping beside his mother when Rico crushed her head with a wooden stick. Anna P. tried to protect her son. Afterwards, Rico copulated with the body. Anna P., who emigrated to Switzerland in 1982 with her son and husband, was in Bratislava with her son for just a few days for New Year's. So you can see just a happy getaway, which your son can turn into something gruesome just because some weird-ass guy wants to have sex with a dead body. And now for a little bit better news. Jenna B., 31, she became the first person to survive Rico's attacks. On January 9th, 1991, she fought him off after being attacked in her probably first floor Bratislava apartment. Her quick decision to fight, coupled with a poor weapon choice on Rico's part, allowed her to come out of the confrontation with only a couple of wounds. Rico gained access through a ventilation window above the door, and he had an unsuccessful attack. He tried to attack her with a stick, which was rotten through and through. So he started to smash her in, but the stick broke. He quickly fled the apartment. Jenna B. noticed that Rico's light blue pants were hand sewn in the crotch area. This was an important thing to notice, because later in the process, this would be something that identified Rico. The same night before this attack, Rico also entered through another window in the neighborhood. But it only led to a locked storage room, so he did nothing inside this building. 3 weeks after his last kill and 2 weeks after the attack on Jenna B., on an unspecified date, he murdered Helena N. near Saradnica Street in Bratislava. I'm really sorry if I butcher all these names. I have absolutely no idea. It's already hard enough to speak English and trying to sound not completely half Dutch, half English. So I'm sorry for butchering these names. This was on the same street as the last murder scene, according to some sources. Or at least it was very near to where he killed Anna P. Here he removed a net from the kitchen window. There was a ground floor apartment, so it was easy accessible. And he killed Helena N. with a piece of concrete, just like the one he killed in Amsterdam. He used some part of the street to bash her head in. Next up was Henrietta. She was attacked on July 14th, 1991. Rico gained access to her Bratislava apartment through the window, which she probably left open. It was a hot summer night, so I can imagine having a little breeze inside your room is just lovely. Only not knowing that there is some psychopath running loose, killing women and raping their bodies after they died. She was playing on the guitar later through the night, and Rico smashed her head, raped her, robbed her, and just left her for dead. Henrietta, however, survived the attack. but 18 days later she still died. Together with Henrietta, also her grandmother was sleeping in another room of the apartment. The problem was that her grandmother was partially deaf, so she didn't hear Rico raping her fatally injured granddaughter, which she's just absolutely sad to hear. But it was probably also the thing that saved her life, because I'm afraid if she intervened in the raping process, she would also be killed, unfortunately. His last victim, Matilda Yu, was 67 years old. She was murdered on March 4th, 1992, in the center of Bratislava in a... That night, Rico was in the movie theater Dukla. It's today known as the YMCA. Not the song, but the theater. He was together with his girlfriend to the movies. Can you imagine this? He took his girlfriend... He had a girlfriend, first of all, which is already boggling my mind. He took her to the movies. They were touring home together when he suddenly told her he had to take care of something. And he got on a trolley bus. That night he didn't come home to his girlfriend, which is also just weird. And an article in the Kosopi Sarm. My god, all these names. I will pick a case which is a little easier to say next time. There's another unnamed victim from Bratislava. He killed her with a knife, but it was never proven that Rico killed her. The victim was a woman. She was found in the morning by a son who was sleeping in a child's room. And this murder is still unsolved as of 2008. And the weirdest part of all these murders is that Rico gave some of the items he stole from his victims to his unnamed daughter. They kept her name out of the records because they didn't want her life ruined as well. These were all his kills and attacks on women, which is just, when you sum up, this is just terrible. He seemed like a normally functioning guy, you know, he had a girlfriend, a daughter. He went on with his life, and just because he got caught stealing something and decided to kill her, he woke up some kind of fetish inside himself, which forced him to kill other people and have sex with their dead bodies. Andre Rico was arrested by the Slovak criminal police on March 4th in 1992, only hours after his last murder. He was arrested by Vakalek and probably some other policemen in Hotel Carlton in Bratislava. He was employed here, as I said in the beginning of this episode, as a satinier in the cloakroom, so probably someone who took the coats and hung them on the correct hangers. At the time of his arrest, he was still without his socks on, which he used in his attacks. You know, he put his socks on his hands, and they found him without his socks. So that was a little piece of the puzzle. Not only was he not wearing any socks, he also had blood on him. He claimed it was syrup. And that the sperm found on the victims was arranged by a prostitute from an erotic club. So he said that a prostitute stole his semen and planted them on the victims to probably frame him for all these murders. He also explained that his footprints beneath balconies and cigarette butts by claiming he was there by chance and either had to pee or that he was curious and took a look through some windows. And last of all, he explained his possession of jewelry by saying that women often gave him gifts. So at this point he just started to scramble for lies and started to make up some weird story why he was there, how he got stuff on him, how he got certain jewelries. It was complete bullshit and I think the police saw right through him. Jenna B, the only survivor of his crimes, clearly saw Rico's face because inside the apartment where she was, where she fought with Rico, there was still some light from the street light. She would later actually attend his trial wearing a wig to remain unnoticed to Rico himself. The criminal police of Germany, Netherlands and Czechoslovakia investigated Rico's murder separately. It was only after his arrest that they started cooperating in the case. And this was mainly because his modus operandi was so... there was such likeness in it that they could connect these cases to each other and started working together to make a full case against him in three separate countries. A former investigator, Judor Joseph Vakalek, recalls Andre Rico's arrest, saying he was still in trance, like a snake who just swallowed its prey. There were traces of blood on his shoes and trousers, and inside his locker there were jewels belonging to the victim. So it was just clear to the police that he was the killer, and they had him. On December 7, 1994, Andre Rico was sentenced by the city court of Bratislava, after a trial that lasted 10 days. They sentenced him to life in prison in the third class, which means highest security prison in Slovakia. When details of his crimes were read to him in court, Rika did not react in any way. He was just sitting rickety and leaning a bit forward. His face showed absolutely no emotion throughout the entire trial. And his entire case consisted out of 5,500 pages. He was chosen for a life sentence because he was directly or indirectly proven to kill 9 people, based on the especially brutal way he killed them, and the fact that the possibilities of reconciliation were quite limited. The prognosis was really bad that he would change and would stop killing, so they decided to put him away for life. There were also DNA evidence presented in court consisting of blood and semen from the females, the victims' vaginas, as well as testimonies of 194 witnesses. These include witnesses from the Netherlands and Germany, as well as from Bratislava. Rika himself never pleaded guilty to any of the murders, and it just seems that he doesn't feel guilty as well. He appealed his first order court sentence, and in his appeal he claimed he is innocent without giving any kind of proof. So just he just started to throw out these words and trying to get out of it, but it was clear that he was going to prison. His appeal process in the highest of court of Slovak Republic started on February 27th, 1996. And what the conclusion out of this process was, after a day, the Senate said, you're still going away for life because there is no other evidence coming forward and it's clear you are the killer. And after an unknown number of years in a Ilava prison, Rico was transferred to Leopoldov prison. According to the court-appointed psychologist Anton Heretic, also who wrote the psychological evaluation of this weird killer, during the trial, Rico is a sociopath. That's what he came to the conclusion. He does not accept any social norms, he is lacking empathy, and behaves very impulsively. In the same time, he is a schizoid, unable to create relationships with others. He has strange thoughts and hobbies. He is a loner. He is a combination of dissociational and schizoid psychopath, creating a very dangerous type of criminal. And according to his psychological profile, the strangeness, lack of hospitality and language barrier in a foreign country could have influenced his later behavior. Rico found by the psychologist to not be a sadist, which is weird because he did stab the dead women repeatedly while sodomizing them, but it was probably out of sexual arousal instead of just enjoying getting pleasure of stabbing them. And it's a weird difference between being a sadist and being sexually aroused by it, but there is a difference. And according to the investigator Josef Vacelek, he had a low IQ and seldom talked, but he is an investigator, so it can be proven. I already heard this from a psychologist. While being incarcerated in the Ilava prison, according to the guards and everyone in the prison, he behaved according to the norms most of the times. But according to pedagogist Daniel Blasco from Ilava prison, he would often react too aggressively. Chances for his corrections are zero, said Blasco. According to him, it was difficult to communicate with Rico because he seldom said a coherent sentence. So after this gruesome story of this weird killer, one positive point, talking about the survivor Jenna B, just seeing what kind of badass she was. She took some karate classes, which helped her defend of Rico Andre. She also never moved from her apartment or her flat after the attack, and she continued to live there, claiming she did bought a dog and have the lights on during the night for 7 years after the attack. But that's completely normal after something that weird happening to you. But all in all, she came up for herself, she defended herself, and kept on living a normal life and not being affected by this psychopath who entered her apartment unwillingly and started to attack her. This was the story of Andre Rigo, the international killer, the sock killer, the necrophile, the serial killer, the reason I chose this one is because he killed someone in Amsterdam. It's a place where my parents are from. They also lived there during his murder, so that's why I sort of chose this one. Not a fun story, absolutely not a fun story, a weird guy. And unfortunately, still alive after killing 9 people. So let's hope he dies soon as well. Hopefully, you liked this episode. If you did and you listened on Apple Podcasts, leave a review. Let me know how I'm doing. Let me know what's going on. You can also follow me on Twitter @TenebrisFabulas. Just follow me. I will post some updates there if you're if you want to know more, if you want to keep following this podcast and continue on this journey with me. I'm also at 200 followers, also almost at 200 followers, I should say. And when I hit the 200, I will make a extra episode about a paranormal occurrence. So follow me, and who knows, you will see a bonus episode on your regular scheduled episode. It will not take over a regular scheduled episode. It will still come out normally. This will just be an extra. So thanks for listening. Hopefully, you will be there as well next time. And have a great night. Stay safe and stay curious.